James's Church Piccadilly. If you've not been here before, you're especially welcome. It's wonderful for us to be hosting the key exhibition which you see around you. There are 40 unks, which was a symbol I wasn't personally familiar with until this exhibition came, but as many of you know, it's an Egyptian hieroglyph reading life and is a symbol of peace and harmony. So we have 40 unks which have been presented by Eastern and Western artists, and we'll hear later from the curator of the exhibition, Gordon Chandler, to say a little bit more about that. We're really delighted to be hosting this lecture.
Pleasure.
We're delighted to have Nasser David Khalili with us.
Who is part
of our parish, in fact, here at St. James's. And it's appropriate for us to combine the themes of religion and art, as we do very often as a Christian church, because this building itself is a work of art. The natural light pours in from the windows, which our architect, Sir Christopher Wren, in 1684, designed to be clear to the church. And in this building itself, in this work of art itself, those of us who gather here every week for worship are pointed beyond ourselves to the creativity of God. And so we host many events here that discuss the nature of art, what art does in our lives as human beings, how art can provoke us, can sometimes subdue us, can stimulate us. And tonight we're honoured hearing Nasser David Khalili speak about how art can be a powerful unifying force. And so you're very welcome to St. James's Church, where we have been privileged, as I said, to work with Reverend Paul Gordon Chandler, who's brought to London this inspirational exhibition, The Key. And so would you please welcome now Paul Gordon Chandler.
Good evening. It's on behalf of CARAVAN, and I serve as the president of CARAVAN, I'd like to warmly welcome all of you here this evening. It's really an honor to have you here. This lecture is organized by CARAVAN, which you may not know. We were just told a minute ago about this exhibition, which I'll give a little further information on in a moment. It's organized by CARAVAN, which is an international peace-building arts NGO that exists to build bridges through the arts between the creeds and cultures of the Middle East and West. It originates out of Egypt, the CARAVAN Initiative, where we discovered actually that the arts can be one of the most effective mediums to enhance understanding, bring about respect, enable sharing, and certainly deepen friendships between those of different creeds and cultures. In some ways, what we've discovered is that the arts aren't all about interfaith dialogue, but they're very much about providing these encounter points, addressing a specific topic that facilitates interfaith friendships, which is something far deeper than interfaith dialogue, because it involves the investment of yourself in the other. And that's very much what this is about. And every year we host a major traveling exhibition that begins in the Middle East, travels to Europe, caravans to Europe, and then ends up in North America. And it's always around a theme, and it involves premier Middle Eastern and Western artists. And so this exhibition is called The Key. And as it was mentioned a minute ago, it involves 40 different artists, Egyptian, Middle Eastern, and Western. The majority are Arab from the Middle East. Each were given this ankh, which is, of course, in art, we're presenting it as, from what we know, the oldest symbol or the most ancient symbol of harmony in the world. And really, it's a canvas, if you will, for a contemporary message of hope, of peace, and tolerance, in the midst of this current chasm of misunderstanding and discord that takes place, currently taking place between the Middle East and the West. In essence, this exhibition, The Key, is about uniting people of different backgrounds. And within that context, we're privileged to be hosting this lecture, which we're calling the CARAVAN Arts Lecture. And for us, it entails an individual of artistic, literary, or academic, or even religious distinction giving a talk on the transformational power of art in regard to peace building. And tonight, as was mentioned, we're very honored to have Professor Nasser David Khalili with us and as our special speaker. And to introduce him, we're also honored to have Dr. Benicia Porter, who's the curator for Islamic and contemporary Middle Eastern art at the British Museum. And she's going to come and introduce our special speakers. Would you please welcome.
Thank you very much for your generous introduction. Going back to our old days, as you very well aware of, I was always an admirer of British Museum and what it stands for. So when the opportunity came to do the Hajj exhibition, I was more than glad to participate and make sure that it would become the ultimate success, which it did. Tonight, first, I have to thank the organizer for being brave enough to invite me to speak about the Islamic art or about the 8 collection that we have put together. One of the things that I always say in my lectures when it comes to art is that we are living in a very complex world. People talk about religion and politics and very rarely bring art into it. And one of the things I say always is that religion and politics has its own languages, but the language of art is universal. That universality can be very handy in the very complex world that we live in today. I give exhibition all over the world. We have done many publications related to our eight collections and to the exhibition, over 70 of them. We probably have about 35,000 pieces in eight collections. And what I realized during the collecting activities of last 40 some odd years, I realized that each time you give exhibition, virtually every single time, you somehow inform people. I just don't like to use the word educating people because that is very arrogant. But it is nice to inform people about the culture around them, because different cultures have different messages. Different art have different messages. So tonight, I'm going to put you on a very sort of a fast track, just to give you a bit of a tasting of a different type of collection that we have managed to put together. Just to tell you that almost 95% of all the publications have been done. So the eight collections, except the Islamic, they are probably short of about 8 volumes or 9 volumes. By the time we do that, we have done about 90 volumes that would cover the 30 some odd volumes of Islamic, about 10 volumes Japanese, and the rest are each volume of the other collections. Let me take you through and tell you what I'm going to do is I probably would show you some slides, and in the course of it, I'll tell you some of my personal experience of how I bought them, how I was attracted to them, and why I did what I did. When I was born in Iran, so that is my birthplace. It's a Muslim country that they have been always extremely hospitable to the Jewish communities in Iran. So I fell in love with Islamic art, not because it was Islamic and not because I was living in a Muslim country. I fell in love with it because I realized that it's probably one of the most diverse art in the world. Unlike when you go to an exhibition of Picasso or Da Vinci or Cezanne or Giacometti, whereby you see an art which is the brainchild of one person, Islamic art is totally different. It's fusion of nation, it's fusion of intelligence, it's fusion of know-how of different nations when they got together. Because Islam conquered many countries. In one stage, they virtually conquered half of the world. So each time they conquered the country, they brought their know-how and fused it with the know-how of the country that they conquered. So it is by far more complicated than just talking about normally one exhibition, looking at one painting and looking at the same thing. And nowadays it happens all the time. Islam started in late 7th century, or mid 7th century, 1613. When the Quran was commissioned to be written, it was written in this form that called Mayel. Unfortunately, because it's almost 1400 years ago, there are not many pages that survived. There is no complete Quran, even the one that we have at the British Museum, which was at the Hajj exhibition, is, if I'm right, is almost half, am I right? So it is not complete either. So we are blessed to have a few pages. So this is two of the pages of the early pages of the Quran written in Mayel. We are very lucky, we have two royal Qurans in our collection. This one is written for one of the big patron of Safavid dynasty in Isfahan. It's written for Shah Tahmasp. We are blessed to be able to have his rock crystal seal, royal seal. When we bought the Quran, somehow that survived. In one stage, it was given to one of the Indian kings, because the relationship between Iran and India was very close. In actual fact, when you look at the last 500 years of Islam, there were three dynasties. It was the Mughal dynasty, Persian dynasty, and Ottoman dynasty, and they were almost simultaneous. So they started about mid 15th century and finished early 21st century. So this was given by one of the Persian kings, by Shah Tahmasp, one of the Mughal kings. It was in his library. We have in the beginning the handwriting that it entered Shah Jahan's library in one stage. So it is extremely eminent, and we are blessed to have this Quran in our collection. It's written in gold throughout, and illuminated in virtually every page with lapis lazuli. So the blue that you see is lapis. Now, just to show you the status of women in the Islamic world, this Quran is written by a princess. She was the daughter of Aurangzeb, who is the son of Shah Jahan, who built the Taj Mahal. And this Quran is written by her. It probably not illuminated by her, but it's written by her. So, because the father was extremely religious, and I come to it in a minute when I talk about Aurangzeb, because we have his album. The daughters became tremendously committed to the religion. Unlike Shah Jahan, who was very secular, Aurangzeb was extremely religious. So they said to themselves that according to the religion and according to the Quran, if you can afford it, if you can do it, and that comes from Judaism too, is that you have to write or commission a Quran for perpetuity. So this is what she has done, and this is the one that she has written, which is in the collection. Poetry plays a huge role in Islam, and in most of the schools, in actual fact, the book of Mutanabbi is what that the students study. I'm sure I was told by some friends that now in Egypt, in Lebanon, in Syria, in most of the places, a lot of people are still using Mutanabbi's poem. The important thing about this book is that it was read to him before he passed away, to get the permission from him that it is exactly what he said. So it's a copy that had been run by him before he passed away. So that is the significance of this. There are other copies which are not that early, because this is the early 14th century. There are later copies too, but this is one of the early copies that we know of. Going back to Aurangzeb, I have to tell you the beautiful story. This is the Aurangzeb album. But to tell you the story, which is interesting, is that I was in India with my family about 10 years ago, 12 years ago, and we had a guide. So I was walking with the guide, going to different places in Agra and in Jaipur, and I was telling him out of blue, because we were exchanging information between two of us. I said, we know that there is a Padishah Nameh, which is full of miniatures, and those were commissioned by Shah Jahan. The bulk of it is in Her Majesty's collection. I'm coming to the page that we have. And I know that Aurangzeb was not that secular. He was extremely religious. In actual fact, he put his father in prison. He put Shah Jahan in prison. So I said, there is a legend that they said that there was an album written for him. And he looked at me and said, there are talk of album, but we don't know where it is and if it exists or not. I came back to London, and about 6 months later, I have a very good friend of mine who has been a very eminent dealer of mine in my lifetime. I bought a lot from him. He was a very intelligent dealer. For a very long time, I didn't hear from him. One day he telephoned me and he said, you know, I've been very involved with the Qataris, that's why I didn't call you, but I just have bought something, I want you to come and look at it. So I was with my son, with our eldest son, so I said, Daniel, let's go. So we took a car, we went to him, and I saw this album on the table. So I started going browsing through it, and in the beginning I saw a handwriting that I realized and recognized that it is Aurangzeb's handwriting, because we have some Qurans with his handwriting. So I realized that that must be the album. Oliver didn't know. God bless him, he's not well, but Oliver didn't know. So I bought it as an album, not an Aurangzeb album. So that's the story of that. So I came back, and as I was coming out, I told this story to my son, and I said, you know something, that has been a story of my life throughout. I don't know what these pieces are coming to me. Sometimes I just wonder. So this is another story of getting something that I wished for, and we received it when I was in India. This is by this is a little album with calligraphic album, which was written by Sheikh Hamdullah, who is still known as one of the greatest Ottoman calligraphers of his time. The beautiful story that I say some of my lecture is as follows. Sheikh Hamdullah lived toward the end of Salim I, who was the ninth Sultan of Ottoman period, and he was the father of Suleiman the Magnificent. The story goes that one night, Sheikh Hamdullah, who was in the court of Salim, was writing in the middle of the night in his room. He had a little candle next to him, a little the inkwell on its side, and he was using the ink and writing a Quran. He was in the process of finishing some of the pages. As he went back to put his pen into the ink, he realized that somebody is holding the inkwell for him. So he looked back and he realized that it is Salim. It's the Ottoman, the Sultan, that is holding the inkwell for him. So he turned around to him and said, "Your Highness, Your Majesty, this is a great honor for me to be able to use somebody like you holding an inkwell for me." And in return, he turned around to Hamdullah and said, "No, it's an honor for me, because for as long as there are writers and dedicated people like you who are writing the Quran, there will be many other sultans holding the inkwell for you." So that's a beautiful little story that goes with Sheikh Hamdullah. He's a great calligrapher of Ottoman period. In the collection, obviously, we represent glass, metalwork, jewelry. We are representing the entire history of Islam from 7th century to 21st century in every single medium. And all our publications represent the same. We have 6 volumes on Quran, we have volumes on potteries. I mean, we are really representing an encyclopedia of the Islamic culture. So in our collection, we have a fantastic collection of filigrees and gold from Spain and from Egypt. So I'm just showing you 2 examples. Jewelry plays a huge role in Islamic art, and majority of the jewelry comes from India. Why? Because Indians were one of the richest countries in the world at the time. They love jewelry, they love the making jewelries, and in most of the areas, being it the Hindu part or Islamic part, the Hindus were the Maharajas and the Muslim was Nawab. They used to commission to do a lot of jewelry. So this is from Nepal. This was for celebration. But when you come down to the important stuff that was made in India, on the left you have this falcon, which is made out of pigeon blood rubies, with a very big flat diamond in the middle. And on this side, this is the only hookah that you ever see, 3.5 kilos of enamels and gold. And the story of this is very interesting too, because about 20 some odd years ago, it was summertime, I was away. I received a telephone call from one of my dealers, who was a Nawab in India. And he said, "I have something for you. I've taken them to Sotheby's." And they looked at it and they told me, "This is fake. It has been just made by somebody in India. Don't even use it. We waste your time. These people are crazy. They don't know what they're talking about." And I know that the guy knows what he's talking about. So I came back from my holiday. I went to see him. And obviously the piece was okay. But it was so magnificent and so rare that they didn't believe that something like that can exist. So it's all in the collection. It was on the cover of one of my friends who wrote a book about Indian jewelry, and has been exhibited around the world in many exhibitions. We have given about 100 exhibitions worldwide. About 50 of them are drawn from our collection only, from the 8 collection, and the other 50, we give loans of different sizes to different museums around the world. This has another beautiful story too. This is a very well-known piece. It's probably made for Shah Jahan. Is made out of 99 pieces of floorless and carved emerald. Okay? Whenever we have that on exhibition, we talk to the ladies and we tell them, if you're allowed to take one piece from the exhibition and go home, 99% of them come and say, "I'll take the box." We take the enamel box. So that's the joke we have. So the story of that is very interesting too. Obviously, I was covering virtually every single major sales all over the world. This time, again, I was away, and this dealer of mine telephoned, and he said, "I've just bought something. at Sotheby's sale in the pre-Columbian sale. I said, what Islamic art has to do with pre-Columbian? He said, they thought it was pre-Columbian and they thought it was glass. So he bought it virtually for nothing. And then he puts it in front of me, and he knows that, excuse my language, I'm a sucker for these sort of things. And he throws a huge number at me, right? So I looked at him and I said, hold your horses, go slow. You can't charge me almost 500 times of what you paid for. You just bought it 6 months ago. So he turned around to me and said, opportunity knocks on one door once in a lifetime. And I'm not letting it go cheap. So obviously we bought it. So that's the story of that. There is an exhibition of Saljuks in Metropolitan Museum of Art today. They borrowed some major pieces from us. And they decided to put the detail of one of our pieces on the cover. Because this box is famous all over the world, amongst the metalwork of the Islamic world. The reason is that it has a combination lock on the top. Not all of it is there, but that shows you that as early as 13th century, you're talking about a long time ago, they already had, the Muslim have the technology of using combination locks, and that is why this piece is so eminent. The work is magnificent too, so they put it on the book. That is the catalogue of the Metropolitan Museum of Art exhibition. There are probably two pairs of door knockers from that period, the Jazira, which is from northern Mesopotamia, that exists in the world. The two that we have came from very old collections a long, long time ago. We bought them about 40 years ago. But there is another two. Unfortunately, they have been separated. One is in David's collection in Holland, and the other one is in Topkapı Sarayı in Istanbul. And there is a bit of a rivalry now, who is what, but that's the nature of the beast. But these are bigger and they weigh about 20 kilos each. They're monumental. The story of this mask is very beautiful too. There are three or four of these known. One is the Hermitage, the other one is with us, and one was in the sale, which was sold. But the detail on this is artistically profound, as you see. The story goes that about 55 years ago, a friend of mine by the name of Hashem Khosravani, I'm sure Venetia knows him, about most of his collections anyhow, he was in a bazaar somewhere, and in a heap of some objects in the middle of the shop of a friend, he sees the corner of this piece. So he pulls it out and buys it for nothing. He doesn't know what he's buying, but he just likes it. And then later on, he discovered what it was. It ended up in London, was sold to another friend of mine, again, Oliver Hoare. From Oliver Hoare, went again back to Hashem, and then we got it from Hashem. So every of these pieces that you see has a little story attached to it. There are only two gold saddles that we know of that exist, which we think is from the time of Genghis Khan, and this is one of them. There is one in, and I went to see it, there is one in China, in the museum in Shanghai. So we went to see it, but that is not complete, this is complete. It's a 12th century, they say that it was from the route that Alexander the Great was traveling. Gold was extremely precious during those period in any event. So that could not have been done just for anybody. So we assume that it was probably made for him. So it's extremely significant to have something like that amongst the gold pieces that we have. The same music, again, these are the stories that is flowing around all over the Muslim world. They say music is haram. You're not supposed to listen to the music. You're not supposed to play music. That shows you that even the commander of the faith, in Islam, they used to commission objects with musicians sitting around and playing for them. In their palaces, near their hammam, where they used to take the bath, there were objects almost nude throughout the walls. So they used to do these sort of things. So this has musicians sitting around, as you see. And that shows you that if the commander of the faith was the patron of objects like that, this story of music is haram in Islam is nothing but a man-made story. We have a lot of Islamic glass in our collection. Majority of them are intact. So this is one of them. It is 20 centimeters high. It's a cut glass, and it's rare. You find some of them much smaller, and they are broken. In Egypt, they used to have lustre glass. These are so thin that they are almost as thin as a paper. That weighs, for that size of 25 centimeters, that weighs probably about the 30 grams or 40 grams. It's really light. It's like a feather. And it is intact. So I know of many objects in many museums, but they're not intact. So this is one of them. We have five or six pieces. This is the only one that is intact. We are blessed to have 10 of the finest Shahnameh pages in the world. It's a Hotan Shahnameh page called Hotan Shahnameh page because it was sold from Rothschild, belonged to Rothschild collection. It was sold to the gentleman in America called Hotan. Then it was dispersed, 285 pages in all. It went to the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Then there was a tax situation. The Metropolitan challenged the owner. He sold most of them before it was dispersed. Now about 95 pages of them are in Iran with the body of the manuscript, and the rest are in different collections. Carrie Welsh went and picked up 10 before it was dispersed. And again, it was purchased by my friend Hashem. So we have 10 of them in the collection. We are blessed to have 10, including the signed page. And the signed page is that one. It's a naughty one, but that's the signed page. And the writing is right here. I'll show you another one. Sunan Malikian, in the latest article that he wrote in Herald Tribune, called this manuscript one of the relics of humanity, not only a Persian manuscript from Iran. So that's one page. I decided to show you that for a reason, because that's in Nowruz, 21st of March, the first day of spring. That's a real new year, all right? And here, I show you that because even the camels are laughing. So on the left-hand side, I'm showing you the camels who are laughing. That's in Hotan Shahnameh page. That's my discovery, by the way. Now, I was talking about the Padishahnameh. You saw the Aurangzeb album that I showed you. And this one is the pages that Shah Jahan commissioned. And in the bulk of that in Her Majesty's collection in Windsor. That's another story because I had a long chat with Her Majesty and I was showing her the story and telling her the story. So in my lectures, I sometimes pick up, that's Shah Jahan, okay? The size of that is this, which is as small as the back of your small nail, all right? But I blow it up to show you that even when you take a miniature and blow it up, because of the artisanship and the mastery of these artists, you still see a beautiful painting like a Renaissance painting. So that's why I did that for you. This is from Jamal al-Tawarikh, from Rashiduddin. He contributed to Islam a great deal. Again, he was an early 14th century artist. He created the two libraries in Tabriz, where he was commissioned to write the history of the world. There are only two portions of it. One is in Edinburgh, we have the other portion. It had 99 miniatures, 21 of them are this size and the rest are the small ones. One day we are going to bring them together. But he was a Jew who converted to Islam, but his fate was not very interesting because later on he was killed because of some rumors and stories that flew around. I don't want to get into that because that's another story. Probably read it in one of our books later on. Pottery again plays a big role. This is camel plays a big role in Islam, especially in the exhibition of Hajj. As we know, they used to use camel. And most of the Arabs in the peninsula, after their wife, they cared for the camel. So that was the second most important member of the family. So it was very important to them to have the camel. So this is intact, it's not broken. But on the other side, when you see it, you think it's intact, it's a waste. When it was in the kiln, a part fell, but it was baked, so it is intact. We have a big collection of textile, about 300 and some odd pieces. We are publishing two volumes that's coming out this year. Here I'm showing you one Ushak from Ottoman Turkey, Anatolia. One Safavid one, this is the baby of the one in Victor Nobel Museum. In actual fact, when they took it down to clean, we took this one, put it next to it, and we did a test to make sure that it's from the same place. It comes from the same workshop. So that's the baby of the one that is in Victor Nobel Museum, and this one is from India. Some people say that it's probably Shah Jahan's mother, but we cannot identify that because we don't know. But this is what they say about this this piece. The story of this is beautiful too. This is silk on silk. What you see, the name of Allah is a silver thread. It is woven into silk, the name of Allah. We exhibited that in many places, and when it was in Abu Dhabi, one of the contemporary artists, Moshiri, came to me and said, would you allow me to copy this? I said, why not copy it? So a year later, I went to the fair. He had a black canvas, and he copied this with the white Allah. When you put a topping on a cake, he used the same system to do it. So out of curiosity, I said to him, I would like to buy that because it's nice to have something like that because it's very similar to the textile. He said, it's sold. I said, can I ask you how much for? And it was probably 34 or 50 times more than the original piece that I bought 25 years later. That shows you the difference between the real McCoy and this sort of stuff, because unfortunately, contemporary art becoming a commodity, and that's a danger that we are facing. But I'm sure that we somehow cross the bridge one day. There are three or four prayer mats belonging to the time of Shah Jahan. This is one of them. There was one in the Metropolitan that was sold, and now it's in Qatar. And this is one which is in our collection. Again, this is made out of silk, which is rare. Now we're going to Hajj exhibition. This was at the Hajj exhibition when we had the exhibition in British Museum. This is again another daughter of Aurangzeb here, who sent his artist to go and sit in front of the Kaaba and painted stone by stone. This is the earliest actual panorama of Mecca you ever see. And this one is done by our friend Ahmed. We bought one from him too, by the way. Venetia suggested that I should buy one for my next exhibition, which I did. So next exhibition we are putting it. This is magnet, but beautifully done. He's a real master. This is the genealogy of the Prophet. It's one of the earliest ones that we know of, 14th century. The name Muhammad goes throughout every single page till the end. It's incredible. And then it had the whole history. They used to have a lot of textile to cover the Kaaba. For inside of the tomb of the Prophet, which is in the middle, this is the setora or the curtain, which is on the face of the Kaaba, and this is the mahmal. The story of mahmal was not really known till we got hold of it. It wasn't something that was used to put anything in it. It was more or less a political gesture. So whenever they had to send something, and majority of these was done by the sultans in Istanbul or in Turkey, they politically announced that we are sending object for Mecca. Majority of these are signed. This is after the one in Tokop Saray. This is the second earliest curtain that exists. This is another mahmal which was at the British Museum. The other one was 17th century. This one is the 19th century. Again, has this signature of the Sultan Abdulaziz. These roundels, we are very lucky that we have all of them. As you know, the roundel has Allah, Muhammad, Abu Bakr, Umar, Usman, Ali, which is the God, its Prophet, and the four caliphs. So we have all the six. So this is one of them. In 19th century, somebody decided when they were refurbishing the tomb of the Prophet to take some of the earth and turn it into a relic. They learned that from the Christians, so they wanted to do the same. There are only two that we know of. One is in Tokop Saray, and for some fluke, we have the other one. So that is the earth from the tomb's Prophet, which is sitting. In actual fact, the box is big. There are not many coins. This was made struck struck in Hejaz. They call it Madan Amir al-Mu'minin bil-Hejaz, which is what is on that coin there, Madan Amir al-Mu'minin bil-Hejaz. So there are probably four or five known in the world, so we are blessed to have one. I've done many things in many other areas, but I was very lucky to be able to do something for Judaism. There are two groups of documents from the 3rd, 4th century BC that exist in the world. One group was in the Bodleian Library. We were blessed to find this group, which was dispersed in Afghanistan. It was sold to about 30, 40, 50 different people. It took me something like 20 some odd years to allocate them and buy them and put them together. We published a magnificent book called Aramaic Document. And in one of them, for the first time in Aramaic, you see the name of Alexander, which wasn't Alexander, it's Alexandros. So it is in one of our documents. Meiji is one of the wonders of the world. So our Meiji collection is about 1,200-1,300 pieces. These are gold inlaid throughout. The size are phenomenon. It's almost 2.5 meters high. This is the close-up of it. This is the lacquer. When they did NHK from Japan decided to come and approach us to do 3 documentaries, half an hour each, on lacquer, metalwork, and enamel, and they called Zeshin, this artist, and we published a separate book, 100 of his work, as a Da Vinci of Japan. He was an unbelievable artist, and now more and more people are being inspired by him. So we have three or four panels by him, about 100 pieces. Can you imagine a piece of enamel of that size, 2.15 meters, to be able to put something like that in a kiln and fire it? And how many times it's been wrong before they got something like that? Now that was in an exhibition in one of the museums in Japan. We have the other two vases which goes on each side of it. So I'm showing you the centerpiece. Van Gogh, in the letter he wrote to his brother Theo, said, in a way, all my work is based on Japanese art. So we had a monumental exhibition in the Van Gogh Museum in Holland. And what we did, we took 40 or 50 of Van Gogh's paintings and putting alongside some of the Meiji work that we had. So, and we published a separate book just to prove that contemporary and modern art were fully inspired by the art of Meiji art of Japan. This is about 50 kilos of ivory, and it's cut out of one piece. I don't know how, where. Don't ask me, because I even don't know myself. There are a lot of Fabergé eggs. We have a few of them in our enamel collection. But this one is silver enamel. And the story is beautiful too. It's a legendary story of the Japan that the god is trying to find the devils. And because the devils are underneath, he cannot get to them because they slid down. So he's always chasing them. So there is a chase between good and evil, which is again a beautiful story. This is the only egg of that period that exists in the world. As we know, there are 27 Fabergé eggs known in the world. One is missing, supposed to be 28, one is missing. And this is the only Japanese egg that exist. This is the elephant, again the same size, absolutely magnificent. This was in every exhibition we gave, they recorded that the Japanese as the national heritage of Japan. Majority of our pieces are considered as the national heritage of Japan. This is a piece of bronze. I had that in the exhibition, and I took Prince Charles to show the exhibition. He came to it, he thought it was made out of wood. So I had to explain to him, no, it's not wood, it's bronze, because it is just incredible. This is the god of wind and the god of sea in the sea. So we could look at it for 3 hours and you still find something in the bronze. It's made like a jewelry. We just published our kimono collection. In our kimono collection, we have about 215 kimonos in this volume, which represent the three specific periods of Japan. Edo, which was 17th century, the Meiji, 19th century, and Taisho, which is late 19th, early 20th century. So that is the Edo period. This one is Meiji period. And this one is Taisho period. The book was voted the best art book by Financial Times last year amongst the three books. So it's become very popular. It's been translated in 4 or 5 languages already. Then we go to Swedish textile. A lot of people tell me, what the heck did you buy Swedish for? The story goes that I had this claim, and I thought it was 17th or 18th century Persian or Caucasian. So one day, a friend of ours who is in corporate business in the United States was in London, Doris Plow, and me and Michael Francis, who helped me to do most of my textile, said, she's in town, boy, but why don't we bring her and ask her? Maybe she tell us the date. So she walked in, and even didn't open it, it was folded on the floor. She looked at it and said, that's Swedish, that had nothing to do with this, with Islamic order. I said, excuse me? But the whole design is Islamic. Then I realized that they were inspired. So I started to buy whatever she had. At that, as I was standing on my feet, I bought her collection. She had about 40 pieces. And then I continued and combed out the rest of the world, and we have 100 pieces. This exhibition was at Victoria Albert Museum. This guy is one of the greatest Damascene workers in the 19th century. Lord Morrison was one of his first sponsors. And we have some original letter that he wrote to Lord Morrison asking for gold and silver. This one, if you see, it's almost a ton. And it is almost 2 meters by 1 meter. It's monumental. This is another one, again, made out of silver, enamel, and gold. This is enamel, gold, and silver. It's a writing box, again, from that period. They were all at the exhibition at the Victoria Albert Museum. Then we went to Alhambra. I mean, it had been exhibited in about 6 or 7 venues around the world. This was again at the V&A. You look at the size, it's almost 1.5 meters high. And the trunk of it is that thick. And again, it's gold and silver in it. 99% gold, very little silver. This has the connection between Alhambra, because the Muslims were in Spain for almost 500 years. He was inspired, so he knew something like that existed, the 14th century one, which is in a museum, so in Granada. So he copied it. So there is a pair that we have and a single one that's sitting in a bank somewhere. I'm trying to convince them that it doesn't do anything for them in the bank. It's better for other people to see it. Because at the end of the day, nothing that you see on a screen belongs to anybody. Ownership is a myth. We are only a temporary custodian. So today is mine, tomorrow is somebody else's. So it's much better to share rather than just keeping it somewhere for the enjoyment of a few. This is our enamel collection, which has an incredible group of enamels from every geographic centers of the world. This one is 8 panels. How 8 panels survived, we don't know. And it has the emperor's poem. The story of this is magnificent because this is the only royal table that exists in the world. The other one is again in China, but that is damaged. It had the signature of the emperor on the neat of it. I was in Paris. I was trying to buy some furniture for our house in France. I walked in Didier in Paris, and I saw that in the middle of the gallery. So for a minute, I couldn't believe that is real. So I wanted to check and see if there is a signature anywhere. So I turned around and said, excuse me, do you have good espresso here? So he looked at me and said, yes, do you like espresso? I said, yes. So he went to get the espresso. I turned the table on the other side, and I found out that he does have a signature and it is real. Anyhow, we bought it, so it's one of a kind. So these little stories makes the whole life of pursuing art. This is a Fabergé clock. There are maybe 4 or 5 of these known. This is Lalique. It's now being claimed by French as one of the greatest enamel makers of all time. He's very well thought after now. This is 16 kilos of enamel and silver. It was given to, we have 2 of these. It was given, it's the story of St. George's. It was given to the president of France. About some sort of a fluke, we got 2 of them. So on the back, in enamel, it has the name of the president of France. Again, this is about 3,600 ounces. This is the second heaviest piece of silver in the world. But the work is like, it is enamel and silver. But the work is like jewelry, it's unreal. When I saw it 35 years ago on the floor, they took it apart to put them back together. And I saw them on the floor. And I thought they were part of a jewelry object. And the guy said to me, show me the photograph. He said, no, but no, once I put it together, that's how it's going to look. So that is that has been in most of our exhibition of enamel. This is the only silver chariot known in the world. It's 1 ton of silver, enamel, glass, and iron. It's unbelievable. And again, that came out of India probably about 78 years ago. The family took, each of them took part of it. So we bought first a section of it, then we put them together. The last thing which was missing was the lantern. And we had to pay at the end the same amount of money for the full lantern as for the whole thing. When we had that in Leningrad, because we gave an exhibition of enamels in Leningrad, it was by the office of Putin. And Putin walks by, looks at it and says, excuse me, how come you didn't get out of the armory? He thought it was his. And they told him, no, it's not yours. This is part of an exhibition. This is part of our group of our publication, just to show you some of our Islamic book on the top. The Japanese is 9 volumes. These are the other collection. The Hajj is in hand. These are some posters for each exhibition we gave. And let me just finish up by telling you that when I had my exhibition of Japanese for the first time at the British Museum, because they wanted to show the major art for the first time in this country. I didn't want to go anywhere else. I wanted to be the first exhibition. The same with my enamels. We have covered every single major museum in the United Kingdom. British Museum, Victoria British Museum, Cardiff, and Wales. The Wales one was opened by Prince Charles. Last day of the exhibition was unbelievably successful. The last of the exhibition, a friend of mine who was a big judge in Switzerland telephoned me, a lady, and said, I know it's the last day of the exhibition of your Meiji and I heard so much about it. Do you mind if I travel to come to London and you take me to see the exhibition? But you have to take me and you explain to me. I said, absolutely, come. And I was not planning to go. So I go to the British Museum. It was at the interest was from the back. So I see a lot of buses that I'm going up, a lot of crowd. By the time I got to the room, I couldn't get in, right? Anyhow, I took my friend in and she said to me, a lot of people are here, show me your favorite piece. So I took her to a pair of Shibuyama panels, which again we bought from a sale in London, which belonged to one of the royal families in UK. We have 4 or 5 pieces which belong to the royal family, but because it was lacking and they couldn't look after it, they gave it to Christie's in 1936 and the 1920s to sell. So we ended up to have them. So I'm explaining, as I'm explaining, and the crowd were around us, and we had to wait a while to get to the display cabinet. I see somebody is tagging my jacket behind me. So I looked back, didn't see anybody. I continued explaining the history of the piece to my friend. Again, I saw somebody tagging my jacket. I looked back, it was a 6-year-old girl. So I looked at her and I said, young lady, what can I do for you? She looked up like that and said, sir, can you move? I want to read the label. I turned around to my friend and said, now you know why I collect. Thank you very much.
That's lovely.
I hope I didn't
surprise you.
On time?
That was such a wonderful sort of tool d'oiseau of your absolutely extraordinary collection. And I have to say that just on the Islamic side, it's absolutely fair to say there is no major exhibition on Islamic art that is taking place anywhere in the world that does not have objects from the Khalili collection. And you know, not only are they extraordinary works of art that David has individually chosen, he falls in love with a piece and doesn't rest until he actually gets it, as we've heard from some of these stories. But he is extraordinarily generous when people come and ask to borrow some of these pieces for these magnificent exhibitions, so beautiful objects, but also, you know, museums are very bureaucratic places and they need so many rules and regulations about you know, lending objects. And often, you know, people give up with the British Museum or the Louvre and they just go to the Khalili collection because it's much easier and the pieces are just as good, if not better. So I want to thank you very much. Yeah. Open it up to the floor if there are any questions.
They come to you
from our audience. I have a question, actually, and that is, of all these amazing objects, you know, that whole desert island thing, what is the one that you would actually take with you that you could never be part of?
You're not supposed to ask that question.
Well, I'm asking it anyway.
I'll tell you, about, I think it was about 15 years ago, I was in Liverpool, and I didn't know that the biggest Anglican church in the United Kingdom is in Liverpool. So I was lecturing, and about 800 people were in the room. It was winter day, winter time. And at the end of the lecture, exactly like Venetia, a lady got up and said, "Excuse me, sir, before coming here, I surfed your website, and I looked at all these beautiful objects. I have a question." I said, "What is your question?" And she said, word by word, what Venetia just said. "What is your favorite?" So I turned around to her and I said, "Young lady, are you single or married?" And she turned around to me and said, "No, I'm not married yet." I said, "If one day you get married, how many children are you planning to have?" And she said, "I'm hoping to have many." So I said, "And then if somebody come and ask you which one is your favorite, what would you say?" And that was the end of the conversation.
Well, I'm sorry to have been so predictable.
Not easy. It's not really easy. I tell you why it's not easy. Yes. Twofold. First, yeah. I genuinely don't consider myself the owner of anything that I own. And I say that in every time that I give a lecture or travel or I open an exhibition. And I always say to people, you have to understand that the word collector is an incredibly heavy responsibility when it is given to you or you being called a collector. Because a collector, a real collector, has to collect, has to conserve, has to research, has to publish, and has to exhibit. If you don't do anything for humanity, don't call yourself a collector. If you're buying something and taking it home to say, "I have just arrived because I just sold my company and I bought a Picasso," and you invite people for a dinner at your house, don't call yourself a collector. That's a selfish way of imprisoning an object that the world has to see. You see? And these are the sort of a thing that I differ from my other friends who call themselves a collector. I always tell them, go a bit further. Always say to yourself, maybe for the next 20 years, I'm the owner of this, and then what? So share it with people. Make sure that humanity would benefit. And each time, as I said in the beginning, each time you give exhibition, each time you send these objects around to different museums, you bring a new group of ambassadors who become a lover of culture, who understand culture. You fill in gaps in their knowledge. And that's somehow would give me a drive to continue and do what I'm doing.
Well, that's exactly the power of art.
Yeah, that's
it?
Correct. That's the real power of art.
That,
that's absolutely
is that
correct.
Each of these objects, they open a window onto a culture,
correct.
Onto a moment in time.
Absolutely correct. Absolutely correct.
Yes.
Yeah. Where did you start your collections? You're so good at storytelling. What was the story behind that? What was the first thing you saw? How did you start?
I was 13 years old. And God bless the soul of my father. These are all coming out because my autobiography is coming out within the next 6 months or so. It took me 14 years to write it, but all these stories are there. There was a minister who was a minister, the guy who was the minister of culture called Mr. Mehran. And my father was a friend of his. He used to go to him and buy from him and sell to him too. So he took me as a kid because I always fought with him each time he went anywhere. I wanted to go with him, right? And he gave up. So when I wanted to go to an address to sell something or buy something, he used to take me by hand. When I was 7 years old already. So by then I was 12, I think. So I walk in, and on the table, there were a couple of pieces of Persian lacquer. All right? And my dad started to talk to the minister about a mirror case. And this pen case is sitting on his own. I picked it up. 5 minutes later, the guy turns around to me and said, "Son, what are you doing?" I said, "I'm counting." He said, "Counting what?" I said, "There are 820 faces on this lacquer piece."
We need you to talk in the microphone. Thank you. Sorry, they can't hear you.
There are 800 figures on this lacquer piece. About 400 of them are horses, and the rest are human figures. The background is X, Y, and Z. I just went and explained it like I'm painting it myself, right? He looked at me and said, son, you've been looking at these things that closely? So what is your opinion of the piece? Now he's challenging me. Don't forget he was the Minister of Culture. So I turned around to him and I said, the difference between what I see here and a painting on a wall is very much like a horseman who is in the middle of the field showing his skills. Take the same horseman and put him in the room on a horse and ask him to show his skill. There is a huge difference. I said, this is a horseman in the room showing his skill. Because being able to create a battle scene on 25 centimeters by 5 centimeters surface is a miracle. So that's how it started. He gave me the piece free, by the way, and I still have them in the collection.
And that was the area.
You see it when my book comes.
And that was the area.
Yeah, that's the area. And I didn't actually have my PhD later on.
You did your PhD on that. Yeah, and that, so perhaps on that desert island, I'm going to press you on this one, actually. It may be that little piece of lacquer that you are going to take away with you. any other questions?
I have a question. You've run the Maimonides Foundation.
Absolutely.
Founded, which is about interfaith.
I was just mentioning that he is the chairman of the Maimonides Foundation.
Doesn't work.
Interfaith education, actually, and they have a marvelous program called Explorers. And if you haven't looked it up, I would encourage you to do so. I would love to hear a little bit about how you see art in regard to its effectiveness in facilitating peace building and interfaith relationships.
When I decided to do the foundation, I'm a bit of I challenge myself a lot. So I was born as a Jew. I always say that every human being is born as a human being first. Religion is what is given to you. You don't choose your religion, right? And the basis of all the religions are almost the same. There is by far more that unites different religions rather than divide them. Unfortunately, again, this being misunderstood. But then through my collecting of this, especially in Islamic art, I realized that in majority of the time, in a workshop when they were producing these arts, there were Christian artists, Jewish artists, Muslim artists working side by side. Because for them, creating art was a contribution to humanity and to their faith. They didn't look at it as, I'm Jewish, so I have to do only Jewish art. Or I'm Muslim, I only have to do Muslim art. No, if the Jewish guy was better in inlaying, they hired him to do it. You see? So this difference and this division amongst religion is only 50 years old, 60 years old. It's not really something that was around for centuries, not at all. Not at all, rarely there was the division amongst different faith. And unfortunately, people don't look at it that way any longer because of the ignorance. And as I always say, the real weapon of mass destruction is ignorance. And if we don't tackle ignorance with education, we are going to be in a lot of trouble. That is why through Maimonides, we wrote a curriculum for 18,500 schools in the United Kingdom to teach the children from the age of 9 to 10 to understand that religion is the fact of the religion, that the real religion is what we are telling them based on fact, not based on fiction. Because if they form their own mind, if I give them a campus, at least they could challenge their parents. And I said that to United Nations, because I had this United Nations about it, said the same question as you said. And I said, if we do not create a new generation for the next 20, 30 years, a harmonious generation, we are going to be sitting here talking about this problem even worse than it is today.
Thank you so much for being with us tonight. Yes, we're really very fortunate. Thank you to Venetia Porter as well. Thank you for being with us. We've had a wonderful evening. So please say thank you once more to
thank
Professor
you very much. Thank you.